So I want to talk a little bit more about these fundamental concepts today, specifically talking about functions and the notion of namespaces and scopes. And once we're done with that, we will talk a little bit more about, if you want, more practical things, although these conceptual things are of course of high practical value, although that might not be immediately obvious. So after we discuss functions and namespaces and scopes, we will then start talking about the inbuilt data structures in Python, which I assume you have encountered already now. So I assume that all of you have seen tuples, lists, and dictionaries. But these things one needs to get used to, and it doesn't hurt to hear about them multiple times because then they sink in more, and some redundancy, I think, is actually quite helpful. Or at least that's for me the case, even if I've been using these data structures. Reading about them and hearing about them again helps to solidify this knowledge. Okay, then let's go to the next slide. So last time, maybe briefly rehearsed that. So we talked about the Python basics, which has some features like white space matters. You don't need semicolon. Everything is an object. Python is a multi-paradigm language. We discuss operator precedence, and we discuss the idea of variables and variable types. But then we basically gave up this idea of variables and went more specific in talking about names, references, and the underlying objects. And we discussed then this dynamic typing model of Python. So today I want to start with some very fundamental thing that I guess you also have seen now, namely the notion of .py files, because this is where you store your programs in. And last time we basically just used the IPython console to program a little bit here and there, but now we want to basically start putting programs together. So these .py files, they are just text files. So that's an important thing to realize about computer programs. It's just text files with comments, so Python comments which are executed line by line. And this is, I think, the essence of the .py file, isn't it? So let's go to Spider. Oops, I had one Spider open, sorry. So this is Spider, and last time we did a little bit with our IPython console. So I think we defined some variables, apples and oranges, and then we did something like apples. Ah, some doesn't work. All maybe all fruit. Then we did something like apples plus oranges and got five, but we entered everything into the console here. And the next step then is that instead of putting things into the console, you can write .py files, and I assume you have seen that. So you can create a new .py file just by saying new file. And then you can write up these kind of commands. So just for demonstration purposes, number of each fruit item, and you can, what we've just put into the console, you can write into this text file. And then you can write the same things that we just wrote up here. And if you want to actually get a visual output in the command window, or the console, I should say, because we are not in MATLAB anymore, then you need to use this print function. And if you write print fruits, then the value of fruits will be printed to the console. So I have a coding style where I really like things always to align, so that's what I did here. Here with this hashtag you introduce comments, and it's a good practice to comment a lot. So that's especially for scientific programming. So if you look at books like Clean Code, so there's a book called Clean Code, sometimes people say comments are unnecessary evil. So ideally you would not want to write comments, because your commands would be self-explanatory. That is in general true, however, especially in science where variables often encode some other interesting scientific things. For example, you have an expectation vector of a Gaussian, but this also means I don't know, some neural activity or so. Then it of course makes sense to write an explicit comment that this is your expected neural activity, something like this, which is not, which you just can't convey in a Python command, unless you call your variable neural activity expectation, which you can do. Then you might not have to comment that much. So here I'm just commenting a little bit, number of apples, that's number of oranges, and in a way that's also not really in the command, because it could also be that another interpretation of this command, apples equals 4, could be there are apples and we're interested in the fourth, so we are not indexing anything, but we're just defined that of the class apples we want the fourth, and then maybe use this later, and that would be then a different meaning. And with the comment I'm specifying the meaning a little bit more. Total number of fruits, so I'm all for commenting every line and convey meaning of every line, because code by itself is, it's hard to make it completely transparent what code is doing, also conceptually, just by the commands. Print total number of fruits, so this is a comment that I wouldn't actually write normally, so print total number of fruits to console. This is really apparent from the command, so in general I wouldn't write this comment. In any case, I now I've hidden my scroll bar. In any case, this is a little computer program and we can execute this. We might first want to save it. Let's call that PyDemo. And I'm not 100% sure why it didn't do that, but we can actually do that here. So so it did, it executed it, so you see that it ran and it printed the number of fruits. What I want to do is this. So often when you for the first time execute a new program, then this configuration, oh sorry, it's in German, this configuration comes up where you can specify from which directory you execute this, and other configurations, and they're actually quite important. So the way I'm working with that is that I usually execute Python files .py files in the running console, so this is the current console, and I also delete all other variables before execution of this. This will come up when we talk about scopes and namespaces, and it's it makes sense and to make sure that what you write in the text file is actually you can understand it, and there's nothing from previously in the namespace that then might appear. So for example, if you wouldn't do all variables, delete all variables before running this, and you would write the following, so we just comment this out, so oranges is not defined, then oranges here is not defined. However, if it's existing in the namespace, it could be used. So I highly recommend in MATLAB this is clear all, or in MATLAB you run scripts, you don't have scripts, but you run everything in function, which is much cleaner than this whole script business in Python. But you can basically emulate this in Python by always ensuring that you delete all variables before the execution of this program. Then I also always keep this debugging modus on. And this leads to the fact that if there is an error, it you get control in the console and you can actually see what's going on. So the way I use this, maybe you have other ways to do it, but I was quite used to using the keyboard function in MATLAB, which stops the execution of the code and lets you interrogate what's currently going on. And this is what I emulate in Python or here in Spider now with Q, because this is always this results in an error, but because I configured the execution in such a way that it goes to the debug mode, once it gets an error, I then get control in the console. So let me show you that. So now I run, now it gets an error, so because the name Q is not defined, it doesn't know what Q is. And you get into this interactive debugging mode, which you see based on, or what you identify on this based on this IPDB. And there you can now interrogate what's going on. Can somebody remind me of the name for who? So which shows all of the variables currently defined. I thought it was dir, but it's not dir. Is it dir? Ah, it's like this. Yeah, this is what I want. So dir, if you call it properly, namely as a function, then you see all the names or variables that are currently defined. And there are some variables that you didn't define some names. Do we see something? So that are just there. So built-ins, file name, and so on. So they are just there. But there are also the variables that we defined. So you see that there's apples and oranges. Let me quickly check whether we get some useful information here. Now. So with this double underscore dic double underscore, you can often get more information on the objects, although this is now not that helpful. In any case, the point that I'm trying to make here is that you can, and this is usually when you develop programs something that you need, you can interrupt execution of the code at this point, and then you can check what the values of your variables actually are. So first of all, you can check which variables exist. Of course, here it's very simple because you see you define apples and oranges, and then of course you have apples and oranges. But of course, if your program is longer, you might not have the complete overview of what's going on. And then you can interrogate in the console to check the values of these variables. One thing that I also use this for is when I want to now write a new line and I want to make sure that I keep use the correct syntax, then I often first try it out in the command in the console. And if it works there, then I just copy this and put it into there, because I that saves you from having it somehow misspecified in your text file, then running into an error, and then figuring out what the problem is. So you figure out what the problem is first, get the correct syntax, and then you can just copy it into your text file. Anyway, that's how I do it. There are other ways to do this using the debugger, which where you can define stop points and so on, but and breakpoints, but I never use this because I don't want to. Anything else here? No. One thing, so these PI files, so I showed you how I configure them and how I use essentially kind of an interactive debugging tool all the time when programming. One thing you should realize is that all the Python code that you use, so toolboxes, are essentially .py files. So a PI file which has a number of definitions of functions in it is then called a module, and many or a couple of modules together are called a package, and a package is what is called what is a toolbox. So it's just called package in Python. So yeah, that's the other thing about the interactive debugger. You end it with Q, so this is why I put a Q in when I want to enter the interactive debugging, and then if you want to stop debugging, you can exit this interactive debugging by putting Q in. This is, I mean, you could put anything here to break it, but you get out of the interactive debugging mode by Q for quit. So the point that I was trying to make was that all toolboxes and all modules, for example NumPy for numerical computing, essentially exist as PI files. And the question is just where it is, and that might be sometimes a little bit hard to find. So one way to find that is if you do help. And so here I'm importing this NumPy module as np, which is the common way to do it, and then you do help, there we go, just a little bit slow, then you see where your packages are stored. So let's go there, sorry, that was wrong, let's go here. So this is actually, I mean, you can also remember where it's stored, but it's in a folder on your disk called program data. Of course, it depends, I guess, a little bit on your installation and whether you run everything on Mac because you have too much money, or you run everything on Linux because you have no money at all, or on Windows because you want to support Bill Gates, and you know what Bill Gates has done. Huh? Anyway. So Anaconda is installed in program data, and then in libs, I think it was, nope, in lib and site packages, you find all your toolboxes. And here you can see that there are many. So for example, matplotlib, where's matplotlib? Pandas, for example, is here. Jupyter Notebook you can find somewhere here, and you can find Conda, but now we want to find NumPy, and here you then find a lot of stuff for a lot of code relating to NumPy. For example, if we go to FFT, which is of likely related to Fourier transforms, you can look at the code. And some code is easier to understand than others. So these initial, so these are usually the maybe the things that start up Python. Actually, I can show you. Ah, did I install it here? Yeah, I think I also installed it here. I have a toolbox here for convex optimization, which we will use in. For support vector machines, which is called CVX. There we go. And here, for example, you get, which is more an apply, it's more an applied program here, so it's not that low level, it's a little bit more high level. You get a lot of explanation of what it's actually doing by the people who developed that. So what I'm saying here is that the good thing, of course, about Python is that it's open source, so you can look at all the source code, and you can basically, by navigating to this folder where you have all the toolboxes, you can look at the code of the toolboxes you use, and you can modify them if you don't like what it's doing, although you might have to somehow make sure that you have actually writing rights for this. In general, of course, the idea is that you don't fiddle with the toolboxes, but just use them unless you want to improve them. But yeah, so everything is in terms of this text.py files. That's the main point. And yeah, so that's what I wanted to say about PyFiles. Any questions regarding .PyFiles or what we just discussed? So in terms of those people who program, how do you debug? So do you use this interactive debugger or do you use breakpoints? Can somebody tell me how they do it?
I usually use a debugger named Kite.
And what does that do? So I don't know it.
Most of the time it automatically says, it automatically states the false statements and all the errors, syntax mistakes, etc.
So how does how does that work? So you write some code and then you click on Kite and then it tells you something, or how does it?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I guess that's something one can do. Maybe I try that. Because in a way also the spider editor tells you errors, right? So if you, for example, do this here so that you don't define oranges, then of course oranges is not defined here and you get this, it does some of code analysis and it tells you that you will likely get an error. So is it similar to that?
It's similar, but it's a bit more advanced. Okay.
Good. Any other debugging practice by anyone?
I personally just usually print out whatever variable I want to know about on the console. I know it's not the most advanced way, but it usually works, and you don't have to do any debugging tool.
No, that's fairly close to what I do. I just like, definitely it, in a way you get the same information. So if you print things, So what I like about this kind of interrupting code execution and then getting control is that you can, in a way, also try out the next statement. But I also print often. So when, for example, when I'm writing nested for loops or so, I first make sure that my indices and so on work by just printing them and so on. So yeah, that's also something that I do. But I'm really hung up on this keyboard in MATLAB, which was never the best way to do it, but it's just how I've been doing it for 15 years or so, and now I'm too old to change. Although I'm not even grown up yet, because you're grown up with...
By the way, what's special about this Kite I mentioned, I think it's that it's sort of uses some sort of machine learning technique too, AI based. I don't know if it's the gimmick, sale gimmick, but it automatically shows the list of responses based on your first characters, for example.
The list of responses? What kind of responses?
For example, when you write a statement, it kind of interprets this by looking at the previous statements and infer something new to prevent debugging. I think I'm not succeeding at explaining this right now.
Okay, but it's a good hint, so I actually will have a look and see whether I find that useful. So everybody else, if you don't like interrupting the code or just printing, have a look at Kite. Maybe it's useful. It uses artificial intelligence and random forests. Okay, Then that was just a brief introduction to PyFiles, and now the next thing that I actually want to spend a little bit more time on, because I find it very important that you get into the habit of writing functions, is functions. So functions are functions for me are actually one of the essences of programming, because what functions allow you to do is to break down big problems into smaller problems. So problem breakdown, that's definitely one thing that functions allow you to do. Then, of course, functions allow you to remove redundancies, code redundancies. And encourage code reuse, which is kind of the same, and avoid code copy and paste, so that you have some code and you want to use it in some other context and you just paste it in. So if you manage, or if you package this code into some function, then it's quite easy to use again. Problem breakdown, you can also call this procedural decomposition. That's a fancy way to say that. In all projects, essentially, in all scientific projects, but I guess in all projects that humans can do, that's in a way the most important thing, so that you, if you have a big problem, it's always a good idea to split that into smaller problems, which you can actually finish in reasonable time. And then by finishing all the partial problems, you in the end succeed in solving the big problem. And hence I really encourage you to write functions a lot. At this point I just say I write functions a lot. Sometimes people write a little bit too many functions, but at this point I think you cannot write too many functions. And with functions, I want to then show you how you write functions in Python, and how you use them for code organization. So one thing that I had to get used to with Python is that functions and the way you specify them, namely using the def statement, is executable code, meaning you put function definitions into these PyFiles, and once you run the PyFile, the function is defined and can be used by statements that then follow. That's a little bit different than other programming languages, for example C, but in this case also MATLAB, because in MATLAB the analogous thing to a PyFile is called an mFile from MATLAB, and the entire file can be a function, and then you can call a file, and so essentially calling the file and calling the function is the same thing. And this is not the case in Python. So I have to say that I don't really like this about Python, because you cannot encapsulate things as much as you can if Python, text file is the same thing as a function. You always need to include functions in a script. Having said that, of course, you can import functions from other modules into a given program, and then it is fairly similar. So then it's essentially the same, but you have to have this import step, and then you have encapsulation again. Anyway, it's a little bit of a subtlety, but it was, at least for me coming from MATLAB, a little bit to get used to. Now, functions are, and you should really think also about functions, the same functions that you know from math. So functions have domains and ranges, so they have input and output arguments. Maybe we just briefly write that up. So you know from the mathematical preliminaries, symbols, equation, that a function in general maps elements from a domain to a range, and it takes some input and maps to a value which is the output, and which is written as fx. So let's briefly explain this here. Oops. D is the domain. That's the set of all input arguments. R is the range, which is the set range of all output arguments. And then X is called input argument usually, and f of x is the value of the function. Function value for input x. And in a way, you should think when writing functions, think the same way about functions that you write in Python. And actually, if you define a function, then you need to specify at least the input and the output, if any. So the way to define a function in Python is as follows. So maybe let's go here. Can do that this way. So you use this keyword def, which is a inbuilt Python keyword, and Python then knows that this is going to be a function. And then you write a function name, which of course you need to choose. Oops. Function name. And then you can specify the input arguments of this function essentially in the order that you want to use them, so that you want to specify them. So you put in, maybe if you have multiple arguments, and I will say something about multiple arguments in a second, but you will have one argument, a second argument, maybe a third argument. You can have many. And then, so that's the function, do they call it function declaration line? I would call it function declaration line, but this is where the function definition happens. Then I always encourage, or you should essentially, write some function comment. And you put this, and this is I think a little bit more sensible when doing this in Python. You can write some function comment and help. What I also highly encourage is that you document the input and the output, so that you write up what these arguments are. I think in you might know that there is something called PPE8 or so guidelines of the Python community, how to write Python code, and I think they refer to function arguments also as parameters. One can do that, and this is their convention and so on. I don't do it because when we're dealing with probabilistic models and modeling in science in general, of course we have parameters and we have function arguments and so on, and these are very different things. So I need the proper mathematical nomenclature, so I call these arguments or inputs and not parameters. And then you can specify some outputs, for example, out one. So you document that, and that's just the explanation of the function, and then you write what is called the function body. That is what is actually doing, and that's then the actual commands. And finally, to specify the output, you use the return statement, and return stops execution of the function. And if you provide some output arguments, so for example out one, then this out one will be returned. Yeah, so this is then essentially what comes out. So just to map this, so the input arguments x, these would be these arguments here, the function name here f is this, and the output arguments, so the value of the function for a given input is the out. Maybe let's to make this really clear, copy and paste that here. So and what you also notice is that the domain and the range when writing a function are not explicitly defined, so you don't have to say the arguments all need to be from the set of integers or something like that. But it doesn't hurt to think about what the domain actually is and for which kind of inputs your function should actually work. So let's make this a little bit more concrete. So we define a function here now, and this is fairly simple. So this is from the Lutz book. So we define a function called times, and this function is supposed to take two arguments. And then we can specify our function comment here. This function, I shouldn't say multiply, connects two input arguments by the multiplication operator. There's a specific way why I don't just say it multiplies, a specific reason why I just don't say it multiplies them, which relates to duck typing, as I will explain in a second. Then as inputs, we have x and y. First input argument, so this is now of course a little bit of a redundant explanation, so usually my input arguments have more specific meanings, but this is just a example. Output actually the output, the name of the output depends on how you call the function. So but for the time being I'll just call it z, and call it like this. One thing, always put in who wrote this function. so that nobody steals your code, like crazy supervisors called Zoe Kurzi that then claim that you have done nothing and all belongs to them. And that's then the documentation of your function, and then what follows is the function body. So in this case we would do z equals x times y. We would then document, comment what this is doing, evaluate output, maybe like that, and then we stop execution of this function by return, and we return z. So I hope this is all fine. And now we can actually use this function, and maybe we do that by by many apples, and many apples we set to times, and now we want 10 times the number of apples that we have, and let's have a look whether this works. So what do we have for many apples? Yeah, we have 40. So this is here, this times, this is the function call. We can also, times is a little bit, it looks a little bit like an inbuilt function. So one thing we can also call this, for example, is myFun. And then we call this myFun or func. Then it's a little bit clearer that this is now not trying to be some inbuilt function, but it's our function that we defined here. And again, many apples is then defined, and you don't need to go into interactive programming mode here. You can also just, like we heard, print many apples. And you see what's the output. Now, the way you should think about what's happening here is that you execute this py file, and the first thing that is happening is that this def myfun is called and puts the object myfun into the scope of whatever happening then after, and when the code reaches myfun, then it knows that it's now supposed to work or execute the code that's happening in this function, and it should execute the code that's happening in this function with the arguments that you provide here. So you provide 10 and you provide apples, and then you get into the function. And one way to clarify that is to actually stop code execution once you enter the function, and have a look what's happening there. So we are now here, so this is where the code execution stopped, and we can look at what kind of variables we see here, and we see that we have x and y. Note that we actually already execute apples, oranges, and fruits, but we don't see any of those at this point of code execution. So when this is happening, x and y take on the values 10, and apples takes on the values 4, and hence our y is 4. So we can actually validate that by looking at what these values are. And then z is formed, and z is returned as and is then referenced by many apples. Yeah, so this is quite important what's happening here. So this region of code, if you want, so this where the function is defined, in this in the scope of this function, only the current values of the input arguments exist, and everything else that has been defined before is shielded from that. Yeah, so if, for example, we would we actually call something like this is the problem with Python. It also knows what that is because it searches further. But the namespace that's going on is currently here. In essence, what I want to say is that we are currently in this function and can view what's going on there. Before we get to namespaces and scopes in a little bit more detail, I want to briefly show you this idea of duck typing in Python, because that's something that Python really likes and that is kind of one of the essences of Python. And again, something that from a scientific programming viewpoint is a feature. The question, so it's something, so personally I don't like it. It's but it's a feature of Python, and I see the point for that if you are using Python for programming non-scientific things like websites or some applications. Here we didn't specify what kind of variable type the inputs are, and what we put in at this point were essentially numeric variables, and then this times operator or this multiplication operator returned the factor or the product, sorry, the product of x and y. Now, if we, for example, put in the following, so as a second argument, we put in not a number, but a string, namely apple, and we run this. What we then print, maybe it can even make this a little bit clearer if we put in a blank space there. What we then get out is 5 times the string, so a concatenate string apple 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 apple. Yeah, and what's happening here is that instead of now trying to make some sense of these characters, maybe turn them into their ASCII numeric representation and then computing 5 times the ASCII numeric computation, a numeric representation of apple, it in Python interprets the multiplication operator between an integer and a string as the operation of concatenating the string 5 times in a row. So that means what it does depends on the input. Yeah, so what this operator does and what this function does depends on the input, and this is known as polymorphism in Python. So it depends on the variable type, on the object type, what a certain operator does. And in a way, this is helpful for code flexibility, so you can write the same code, and depending on what kind of objects you actually let this code work, it always does something, and it's kind of quite flexible, so you can use it on numbers, you can use it on strings. This kind of makes things flexible, but also a little bit unpredictable in my from my perspective. And this polymorphic behavior is also known as duck typing, and duck because of the duck. And so the reasoning behind why it's called duck typing is that the code is essentially not supposed to care if the object is a duck, only that it quacks. So anything that quacks will do, whether it's a duck or not. And what's happening with respect to the quacks is up to the object. So it's all about that the these operators in Python can have different meanings depending on the objects that you apply them to, and are quite flexible. Yeah, from my perspective, that's a nice flexibility from a mathematical perspective, where you use programming functions to emulate or to simulate mathematical functions. It's a little bit of dangerous business, because a mathematical function has a well-defined and specific domain. So for example, a function takes in real numbers and not strings or letters, yeah, or some other set. And this kind of specific meaning in terms of the things that a function is dealing with, this is lost in Python. So this is basically sacrificed for code reusability and flexibility. Yes, do you have any comments on duck typing? Is there something that how you always thought about duck typing in Python? Apparently not. So that was a little bit of an intro to functions and a little bit an intro to polymorphisms and duck typing in Python. And the next thing then I would like to discuss, but after a little break, is the notion of scopes and namespaces. We've seen a little bit of that, and actually I confused myself already a little bit on that here. So let's have a brief break, and after the break let's then discuss scopes and namespaces, if there are no questions right now. No questions. Okay, then let's start again at 2:15. Okay, so then for one more hour of programming basics in Python, and the topic now are namespaces and then a scope. So first, what is a namespace? A namespace is a mapping from names to objects. And what this is supposed to say is that, oops, wrong mouse. That last time we discussed that there are objects. So when you do this assignment here, a equals 1, then this object of a 1, an integer, is created. Then the name a is created. And then by this assignment, this is actually good that we are looking at it again, reference creation. A reference is created, and the name A now points to the object 1. And so here we have a mapping from a name to an object. And now if we have multiple names which all map onto certain objects, this is called a namespace, and in Python. And so that's a mapping from names to objects. And the crucial thing about namespaces is the question of name resolution. But before I tell you about name resolution, let me give you three or so examples for namespaces. So one namespace is the built-in functions. So functions like dir, apps, and so on. Then and this namespace is actually created when you start up Python and when you have the console. So once you have the console open, Python knows what you want from it if you, for example, type in dir, because dir, this name, has a meaning to Python, namely this function that tells you what the current variables are. Yeah. So this namespace, so this mapping from names, dir, to the objects, in this case a function that returns these things, exists as soon as you start up Python. And then you can create additional namespaces. So for example, module namespaces, which you create once you read in the module specification. So for example, when we did, so right now, for example, if I say, right now, if I say np square root, for example, of oranges, Python gives me an error and says that the name np is not defined. But now if I import numpy as np and then do np square root oranges, then maybe I should assign that to something. I just didn't press enter enough. Then Python knows what's going on, so it has basically importing numpy as np created a new namespace where all the names that start with np dot and then something now have meaning to Python. Yeah, so these are the module namespaces, and so that's when you import things, and then you have let's call it a namespace of a script. So these are the things that exist if you write something like this. So obviously that's a little bit different than importing something. So you specify or I specify your apples, oranges, and fruits, and if and in this case where it's fruits, apples and oranges have been specified. If I hadn't specified them, Python wouldn't know what's going on, but here they have been specified, so Python knows what apples and oranges are and can compute fruits. So this is kind of the it has a specific name, enclosing function locals, not very meaningful, has a namespace of a script, and then of course there's also the namespace of a function. This is why we're doing namespaces now in relation to function. And it is somewhat important to figure out if you're trying to write code of what kind of names, variable names or function names, Python can at a given point in time make sense. And that's the issue of or the question of name resolution and scope. So that's what is referred to as name resolution and scope. And that's not completely trivial, so I also have to get used to it, because it's of course different from MATLAB, where in MATLAB everything is much more shielded, and here it's kind of transparent in one direction but not in the other direction, which is something to get used to. So what do I mean by this? There is what is called the LBGE rule that is the way that Python tries to do name resolution, the search path for Python name resolution. So the question here is, you type in some command in, for example here, you type in fruits equals apples and oranges. How does Python know what apples is supposed to mean, or what oranges is supposed to mean, or what, in this case, what X and Y are supposed to mean? And Python searches different namespaces in a specific order. And you can see certain names at specific places inside the program and not in others. So let's make this a bit clearer. So there are essentially four spaces. So let's draw something. That's not what I want. Ah, that's also not what I want. It's always helpful if you specify the acronym in the wrong way. The last thing where Python search for a name, so something that you can override but which you can also see everywhere, is the built-in space. So let me explain what I mean by that. So here we go fairly deep in this part of the code where we are in this function, but also in this function we can see things of the built-in namespace. Yeah, so if I execute dir here, so let's maybe make this even clearer by putting it here. Maybe does that do something? I can call dir here, although I'm locally in this function right now, because Python can see the built-in functions also fairly local here in this function. Now the next level where you can actually shield things are the global it's the global space of a module, and for what it's worth, a py file. So these variables that are defined there, which are actually things in the text that we are looking at here, they can be dealt with here. They cannot well, we cannot, and this is in a way the point here, if we don't run this code, so if we would clear all variables, or let's do it like this, if we go up to here, that's I think the most meaningful way to do it. So I now ran the code, but I only defined my fun. Actually, we can even go before that. If I run the code up to here, then Python does not know what apples refers to, because although this is written here in the text file, it's only assigned and invoked. This namespace is only created once this code is run, and then it can look it up. That's fairly straightforward. However, here you can see the built-in, yeah, because that's always there. And then the more local scope is actually that of functions, and you can differentiate between enclosing functions and local functions. To make it a little bit simpler, and because we only have one function and not nested function, I just use this scope here. And now the fun fact is that if you are in a function, or two things actually, if you are outside of a function, let's first look at what's happened if we are outside of a function. So inside this function, there is z, and the function is actually defined once we run the file, and then it's also called here. But if we stop the code here, z does not exist. Yeah, so z only exists at the time that this function is run, but it doesn't exist out of the function. Yeah, so this is kind of the shielding or the scope of these local variables that exist inside the function, but not in the module or the py file. Although actually both this definition of the function has been run and also the function has been run, z doesn't exist. It exists dynamically at the time when the function is actually executed. So if we go in here and stop code execution when we call the function, and then once we are at z, then z exists. But once the function returns its argument, z doesn't exist anymore, and this namespace is shielded. Now the thing that actually confused me in the last hour, and that is also the reason why it confused me, is because it's different Python than in MATLAB, is that the permeability of these different scopes and these different namespaces is directional, meaning that we cannot see z outside of the function, but we can see things that are defined outside of the function inside of the function. And again, I have to say I don't like that. In MATLAB, what you would have to do is to declare variables global so that you then also see them in here. Here you automatically see them. So for example, here we are in my fun. So we currently are at this location. Maybe I get rid of this and run it again. So we are currently here. We can see z. That's why we know that we are there. But we can also see the built-in functions, which is kind of nice, because we might want to use them in our local function. But in addition, we can also see the things that have been defined outside of the function. Remember again, when we are outside of the function, we cannot see into the function, but from inside the function, we can see things that were not locally defined, but that were defined outside. So in a way, if you do this with arrows, then you can see the built-in in the local function, And you also can see, we can just copy and paste that, but I want it in black. Let's make this black. So you can see the built-in functions in the local function, and you can also see the things from your Py file or your module, which is the same thing, inside the local function. What you cannot see is the other way around. So this does not exist. So now I'm signaling not exist with maybe a dashed version. That's too dashed. It's also not quite clear. Let's make them bigger. So you cannot see what you define in a local function, the names in a local function. You cannot see them in the global space, and you can also not see them in the built-in. So once basically before you execute your module, so these don't exist. Maybe I should cross them out to make that clear. So this doesn't exist. So the local enclosing global space built-in rule says that the name resolution then works as follows. So if you come up with a command inside a local function, so you say A, you assign to kangaroo, then Python asks itself, what is kangaroo? And it searches first in the local space. So it first looks into the local function. So if you specify what kangaroo means in the local function, then it uses this. If it doesn't find it in the local function, it looks into what is called the enclosing function locals. So maybe we can include that now, because you could nest functions within functions, meaning you could in this function define another function. Yeah, so you could do def my nested function, and if you would stop execution in this nested function, the next thing where it would look, if it doesn't find what kangaroo means, it would look into this function. So then this function, my function, would be the enclosing function. So that would be the enclosing function locals, so local variables. And but you only have this if you have nested functions. So normally, or quite often, so I don't write nested functions that often. So here you would then directly go from the local function, which is the innermost scope, to the global space. And of course this continues here into these. Now we need to move this back. Or we just bring this to front. And of course these things, they work in this nested fashion. So what we have in built-in goes into the most local thing, what we have in the global space goes into the most local thing, and also what we have in the enclosing function. We can see in the function, but again, not the other way around. Isn't it fun to look someone over the shoulder while they are clicking together things in PowerPoint? Come on, give me the red line. Anyway, this also doesn't work. And of course, this transfers to what's happening in the enclosing function to the global functions and so on. And the LEGB rule is the name of how Python checks what kangaroo now is supposed to mean. So let's also bring this to front. So it first looks into local definitions, then to enclosing function local definitions, then into the PyFile definitions, and lastly looks into the built-in functions. And at the first time or the first location where it finds something, it uses this. And this is somewhat funky, or something that one needs to attend to a little bit. So the way I usually deal with it is that, essentially I avoid similar names between functions and scripts, which is of course not always possible, but usually I try to avoid any kind of name resolution questions by just using very unique names. But the whole point of name resolution is of course that you can reuse names, and depending on how you execute the code, the correct name or the name is interpreted in the correct way. One needs to pay a little bit of attention to what's actually happening. So I have two examples here that demonstrate this kind of permeability in one direction but not the other ones. So now what I also put here is a statement. So first Z multiplies X and Y, and then I add oranges to Z. Note that inside this local function I don't define oranges, but Python knows what oranges is because the outer scope here, so the module namespace, can be seen inside the function. And then if I run this, then I get 47, so 10 times 4 is 40, plus oranges, which is 7, so I get 47, and I don't get an error. Yeah. Now, and that's where one needs to pay a little bit of attention. If I do this, so I define a local name, oranges, here, and I assign it to the object 8. And then if I run this, of course, in a way the thing that you expect would happen. So instead of adding 7 to Z, 8 is added because this was locally defined. Yeah, so I have now get back Z plus oranges. But, and that's something to attend to, if I now look into the global scope, we could actually just run it and then look, but now I'm to make it clear, now I'm here. So I executed the function. So first I set oranges to 7. Then I called the function, set oranges to 8, and added it to Z, and returned Z. Now if I ask what oranges is, it's 7 because the permeability of the function here only goes in one direction. So the namespace that it's in, that encloses the function, the names, they go in. But if I change names here, and what I basically define here does not go out. Yeah. It feels kind of natural, but one needs to be aware of these things. And these, if you actually, these are bugs, I think, that are really hard to find if you have something like that, that you have a misinterpretation or a misunderstanding of what you can see where, and if you change something here, whether this also affects something elsewhere. So, yeah. But in principle, the question of what is kangaroo is answered by Python from inside out. So if it's defined in the local function, then it uses this. If it's defined here, then it uses this. And if it's defined here, then it uses this, which is also something we see here, because oranges here is defined. It takes the first one, so here it finds oranges defined as 8 and stops searching. So it could go on searching and go to the module space and find 7, but because it has already found what oranges is, it stops here and uses this. But again, this new assignment of the name oranges to the object 8 is not taken transferred out of the function. Good. I think this is where I want to stop this business of namespaces scopes. They relate fairly closely to function. That's why I discussed them today. Are there questions? Are there comments? Something that you thought of differently, or something that helps you to remember how name resolution is done, or something that how you think about namespaces. That also.
I think with functions, especially if you call a variable inside of a function, I think that typically, at least the way that I've learned it, is that you always define the variable before you define the function. That way you kind of also, it keeps it also in order to some extent, because for example, right now I think if you called my function before defining oranges, then you'd have an error because you didn't have oranges defined. If you didn't have this line of oranges equals 8 inside of the function. So usually, if you have a variable that you need inside a function, at least the way that I've learned it is that you define that function after you define the variable.
So you would say that basically I'm not quite sure what you're saying, because define the function after the variable. So you mean I put this code below this? That's what you mean, or?
Yeah, typically. I mean, I wouldn't necessarily do it then in the middle, because that's also quite messy, I think.
Yeah.
But yeah, just generally, I think, especially if you have variables that you're using throughout the code, I think often it makes sense to define the variables kind of at the beginning, and then define a function, and then if you're using something with that function, then afterward. That, but I guess that's also a style thing. And then I also had a question about what you expected for when we turn in code, because with the PEP 8 kind of general outline, it says to define variables in slightly different ways, like this what you find to be cleaner of having this space between the name of the variable and the assignment. This is, I'm pretty sure that it, the opposite is said in the PEP 8.
Yeah, I know. So they like this kind of style. So one thing about this, these variables in the script and then inside a function. So one way to think about this, or the way I think about it, is that the everything you actually define here are what would be in standard programming languages would be global variables, so you can see them in all of the functions. On the other hand, if you want to see something that you define inside a function, also outside of the function, then you would have to, in Python, declare that global inside the function, and then you can also see it outside. Yeah, with respect to the order, yeah, so I think the general, so what I try to do when writing functions is that that I use in scripts. So if I have some help or utility functions that I use in scripts that actually do something like data analysis or, yeah, usually data analysis or some simulations, then in these modules I only define the functions. So there is this thing wouldn't exist, and then it wouldn't exist, and I import then this function into another script, and then I use it there, and then I would have to guess, but yeah, then no, I think then it would be the same actually, then it also sees these, so yeah. But in any case, then it's not the scenario that also not the scenario that you mentioned, that the apples and oranges are defined before the function. I think the crucial thing to take from this is that things outside of a function you can see from inside of the function, but things here that you define de novo or you override inside a function, you cannot see outside of the function. Yeah, and that's different in MATLAB, because in MATLAB you only really see what you put in inside a function, and you see what you have inside a function, not outside the function, and only if you declare things outside the function global, you also can see them inside the function. So I'm not quite sure why they do it like this here, but that's how they do it. With respect to code style, yeah, I know there are these PEP rules. You know, there are also the APA guidelines of how to put your reference together. One thing about the PEP guidelines is what they also say is it should make sense or something. So what I appreciate if I get code is, first of all, comments and documentation of functions, and then also, of course, which I didn't discuss, of our entire script. So let's briefly do this here. So a Python demo script. So that's what I definitely want to see in all sorts of code. And so I also and it just is also helpful for you, of course, let's remove this, then we don't have to comment it. It's also helpful for you to comment so that you know what's going on. So it's something you should incorporate in your everyday programming. You should also be aware that if you write code in science, it is expected that you make this code public when you publish your paper, that where this code is used as a kind of for the data analysis or whatever. So your code will be seen by the world. So you should make sure that you are happy to share your code with the world, and you should not first write a messy thing and then, once you have written a manuscript, then decide or then start to make your code readable. So every day write readable code so that you don't have to spend a lot of work making code readable afterwards. So these are the kind of the important things with respect to then things like the alignment, or whether you call these parameters or something like that. Yeah, feel free to follow the PEP guidelines. I think the PEP guidelines don't. So one can improve on the PEP guidelines with respect to visual clarity, from my perspective, and this is what I'm trying to do in my code. And this I have established over many years in MATLAB programming, and I am not sacrificing on stopping now because some Python people think one should do it differently. The other thing is APA guidelines. There were always things that didn't make sense in the API guidelines, and this is why I also find these API guidelines always fairly ridiculous, especially because psychologists think if they know the API guidelines and follow them, then they are doing science. But then it turned out in a recent revision of the APA guidelines, certain things that I always found useless, for example, this: at the first time that a citation is used, all names should be mentioned. So that at the first time where you cite something, it was not Fristen et al., but it was Fristen and then 10 other authors, because that's the APA guideline. What the fuck? I mean, then you have in the intro, you have like these endless author lists. So one needs to, even if there are guidelines, obviously this is just some conventions. So if one can improve upon them for good reasons, then one can. So basic thing is, if you work with the PEP guidelines, that's completely fine with me. Important thing is that you comment a lot and that you document. So by commenting, I mean, of course, these line-by-line comments. By documenting, I mean writing what a certain function is doing, what its inputs and outputs are, and same for scripts. And then these little things like alignment or not alignment, that's up to you and your compulsive, obsessive, or your level of compulsive or obsessive disorder. So, for example, if I see something like this, it's annoying, right? So this is better, but that depends. Yeah. Hello. Hello. Yeah. So maybe did I? So I briefly. I just get a book from my shelf and show you something. So this book here, where am I? Where's my video? I guess you see, I hope you see my video. I don't see it myself. But this book by Robert C. Martin, Clean Code. This is what is a good reference for learning how to write good code. At certain points I disagree, but at other points I completely agree. For example, code quality. Can you do you see what I'm showing you?
Yes, we can see it.
Good, very good. So this is kind of, if you ask what is good code and what is good quality, code quality, that's also my definition. So it's the number of what the facts per minute, because if I read somebody else's code and I constantly think, why, what is going on, this is madness, then this is not good quality. If I don't say that a lot, then it's high quality. And this of course means that code quality is also a subjective thing. But certain things are just visually clearer and easier to read than other things. The thing is, what you also should think about is, of course, that code is executed line by line. So you basically just put together a lot of statements one after the other, and the easier it is to read each statement at a time, the easier it is to follow the logic of the code. So this is of course also why multiple statements per line are usually discouraged in Python, although they then do these things like tuple assignments, right? So that you do this x y equals my fun, and then where you assign two things at once. So yeah, good. Any other questions? No? Okay, then yeah.
Maybe one thing about the LBG rule and the whole thing we just discussed, namespace. I don't know, like, when I don't know if I can, like, fully wrap my head around, like, the theory of it, but like, practically, doesn't it just mean the only thing that, like, you can get out of a function if you use one is the output? Or am I getting this wrong? Like, just if you define variables, they're just going to be used locally, and the only thing that actually comes out will be the output that, like, you define, or like this.
That's also one of the results of this. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Then I think. Okay. Then I can list that.
Unless you specify variables to be global inside the function. So I didn't explicitly address that, but there is a statement called global. Then you can also see these variables outside of the function. But in general, and this is also why I don't like that, you see variables from outside the function inside the function, is that the use of global variables has always been discouraged, because this nice thing that you, at a certain point of code execution, you limit all your variables and you focus on what is currently important. This was also always the reason why in basic programming introductions, one says, yeah, okay, there are global variables, but please don't use them. And Python has kind of this semi-permeability into the function of so that you have certain global variables in this direction. But you're right, so if you define something in here, then the only thing that comes out is what you actually return.